We are going to begin with questions, but I just want to say, before we begin, we are not asking questions about the plot or about specifics of the specific moments in the production, because one of the beautiful things about Sarah's and Alexa's writing is the incredible suspense. It is a thriller, and we want, how many people are going to see it for the first time today? Yeah, we want you to be able to experience the thrill and suspense of this production. So we're not going to ask questions like that, and we're going to ask you also not to ask questions that won't give anything away.
We're going to try to be a spoiler-free panel here.
Yeah, spoiler-free.
That being said, we do want to start it off, and it might be helpful if you guys just hold the mics there, because I don't think they're directional in that way. But Sarah, our first question is for you, and this is a question that will be familiar to some of our audience here that we ask of a lot of our artists, and that is the first inspiration. What was your first piece of art that you remember experiencing, a song, opera, theater, a novel, that really kind of spurred you into pursuing the arts? Mm-hmm. And was there a moment that you were really drawn and knew that writing was the way you wanted to go?
Well, like lots of people who are a bit bookish, you know, I suppose some of my most intense reading experiences came when I was a child. And I had a sort of unhealthy interest in ghost and horror stories as a child. So I'm thinking of stories like The Monkey's Paw. Do you know that story? The W.W. Jacobs, a fantastic story about a suburban couple who make a wish on this rather cursed artifact for some money, and their son dies and is mangled to death, and they get the sum of money from the insurance, and then the mother wishes for the son to come back, and back he comes late one night up the garden path. And it's, you know, even sort of just saying that makes my eyes water with excitement. And I think, so as a child, stories like that had a big impact on me. I loved the gothicness of them, the sort of the bigness of them, and yet the neatness of them. And so I did a lot of writing as a child, and it tended to be stories that were very derivative, very gothic, diabolical twists. So when you see Fingersmith later, you will see exactly where Fingersmith came from. I did actually start a couple of novels when I was sort of 10 or 11, and I always started with chapter 2 because it seemed to me that chapter 1 would be too much work. And and I was absolutely right. Chapter 1 is always too much work, and even now I sometimes leave chapter 1 till quite late in the process and come back and fill it in.
That's curious to me. I love that you start with chapter 2. When do you, in the process, was that true about Fingersmith, I should ask?
Actually, I think Fingersmith wasn't. Fingersmith, of all my novels, I like to have a novel planned out in advance, and Fingersmith is a very complicated novel plot-wise, and I really did have to know where I was going with this book. So I kind of felt confident enough, you know, to start with the narrative, and so I did start pretty much with page one and took it from there. Yeah.
Alexa, I'm going to ask you the next question. I read somewhere, I hope this is true, that your grandfather was a screenwriter. Was he an early influence on you? And can you, and then after you talk to us about your history with screenwriting, can you tell us how you and Bill became friends and met?
So my grandfather was a screenwriter. He wasn't particularly well known. He was more kind of beloved as a professor, a teacher of writing, but he actually died when I was 6. So I didn't know him, but I knew, I inherited some of, you know, the students that would take care of my grandmother, but he left me all of his writing books, and which was really odd for a 6-year-old. And I used to go into his study where the books were and read them. And so I actually started to be interested in writing because of the books he left me and because of the writing that he wrote in the margins of the books. So I would sort of follow his interest, and if he wrote, he would write "ah" after things that meant something to him. And so I taught myself to write plays using some really old-fashioned playwriting books. So I wrote, you know, 5-act plays with, you know, like the butler at the beginning saying, like, you know, "Oh, they're out this morning, but they'll be back from their tennis game later," and, you know, sort of very old-fashioned exposition. And So I have a connection to him, but not in over time. But he was also a theater person, and that really affected me. My grandparents were in the WPA Theater in New York, and he was a stage manager for Clifford Odets, and so they were really, you know, sort of early Cornerstone or early OSF, but sort of in the same spirit of social action, and so that had an impact as well.
And tell us how you and Bill actually met and became friends.
Bill and my husband were in the original van of Cornerstone. But I had met Bill through some other friends. Everyone knows Bill. That's just how it is. So we had been friends for a long time, but had never worked together. So he took a big flyer on me for this project, and it feels like we've been working together for 30 years.
Bill, question for you, and that is, what was the genesis of Fingersmith? Was it brought to you by Alexa, by another source? And when did you decide to produce it, and why?
Alexa and I had breakfast at Brothers, where Sarah and Alexa and I had breakfast yesterday. And she talked to me about this book that she was obsessed with, and told me a lot about it and about her passion for the story and her dream of creating a play based on the book. And you know, we both acknowledged right away that the chances of us getting the rights to do that were very slim, but it was really worth pursuing. And I was just immediately moved by Alexa's passion for the story. And then, of course, I read the book and was blown away.
Bill, how long ago was this? When was this breakfast?
Three years ago, plus probably.
Okay. And then I was making a trip to England. It was in September of 2012, I want to say, and I got to meet with your agents. And they were extraordinarily kind and open, and they brought back the news. Alexa wrote a letter to Sarah about why she was interested. I mean, you guys should pick up that part of the story.
Well, we just wrote a big MASH letter about how much we love the book and what we wanted to try to do and just how much it meant to me personally. And actually, Judith and Toby are here today, so it's especially lovely to have them here, the people that opened the gates to helping us to get access to Sarah. So, but yes, we sort of made a case and were surprised to find that Sarah and her people were open.
Because you've both said that, can I ask why you were surprised or why you didn't think it would... Why did you think that there would be obstacles in the way?
Well, I think when you care about something as much as Alexa did and as much as I grew to, you're vulnerable, right, about the possibility of a no. And I also think because your work is so justly celebrated, I remember Toby talking to me about the oddness of this theater in the United States, the West Coast of the United States, wanting to adapt this British novel, and that seemed unusual. So I think for those reasons, I think it's because we wanted it so badly, you know?
That's nice. Thank you. Yeah. I mean, I just remember thinking, being so intrigued. Mm. I have to confess, I hadn't heard of the OSF. So it's been wonderful, apart from anything, you know, Fingersmith aside, it's been wonderful just to come here and to see so much talent and to see the wonderful productions we've seen so far, and you've been incredibly welcoming. Thank you, everybody. But no, I mean, in terms of the idea for Fingersmith, I just felt it was its its oddness in a way made it quite appealing to me. Yeah.
Alexa, do you remember what you wrote in your letter? Do you remember what you said?
Yeah, I remember saying that sometimes there's a work of art that you read that stays with you. Like, I'm sorry, I'm gonna get emotional, but like a friend. And it spoke to me, as it does to so many people. I'm not alone in terms of Sarah's work, but and that it lives with me in my waking and sleeping hours. So I just wanted to be part of it in some way. So.
I'm just curious, Sarah, have other novels of yours been adapted for the stage?
Not really. There was a student production. My first novel was called Tipping the Velvet, and actually it will be on stage in London later this year. But there was a student production of it a few years ago, so that's my only experience of it, which was, you know, it was terrific and really interesting to see. So I've had, nearly all the books have been adapted for TV, and there's a feature film of The Little Stranger in sort of pre-production. So I'm very, you know, kind of familiar with that process. But I'm a big theatre goer myself, so, you know, that made this a very exciting prospect for me too, the idea of what would have to happen to, not to turn the book into a play, you know, but what would happen in the process of Alexa sort of, you know, bringing her talents and theatrical insight to this book and then creating something of her own, kind of inspired by it. So I was just, on a sort of artistic level, I was sort of fascinated by that.
My stomach just went down to the basement thinking that you are going to see this for the first time this afternoon. The full reality of that just hit me.
But don't tell her how it ends, okay?
I have to say, I did revel sometimes in your worst, what might be your worst fears of what could happen, and that there would be Kardashians and, you know, leather and, you know, the modern equivalent. And
well, shall I tell you what my worst fear was? Yes. Well, for any British person of a certain age or over, the idea of sort of Cockney in an American context, it just brings three words to mind. You know, Dick Van Dyke, basically. Dick Van Dyke in Mary Poppins.
He's left that long of an impression. That long.
Oh, yes. He has scarred British culture, basically.
Yeah.
British emotion. If I'm really honest, that was my first thought. You know, it's such a London book, and it's such a Victorian book, and there is a lot of sort of, you know, it's the Cockney underworld kind of thing, and I'm not a Cockney, you know, so my appropriation of that is as artificial as anything. But I did feel like, ooh, you know, how is this going to play out in a very North American context? Yeah. We're going to find out.
We'll find out.
All right, Sarah, just going along, can you tell us specifically what the genesis of the story for Fingersmith was and what interested you? It's not the only novel that you've set in Victorian England. Can you tell us about the genesis of Fingersmith? And
yeah, sure. It's actually the third novel that I set in the 19th century and the last novel I set there. And I'd gone to the late 19th century very deliberately for Tipping the Velvet, my first novel, which is very much about the sort of sexual underworlds of late Victorian culture, prostitution and rent boys and gay life in Victorian London. And then I kind of got addicted to the Victorians, and so my next book was about another sort of underworld, the world of spiritualism, you know, spirit mediums, and women's prisons. It's set in two sort of different worlds. And with Fingersmith, I'd got very drawn to there's a very particular kind of Victorian fiction called the sensation fiction, the novel of sensation. The Woman in White, if you know that, Wilkie Collins' fantastic novel, is a brilliant example and one of the earliest examples of the novel of sensation. And it was a really thrilling genre in its day. Sort of the 1860s, 1870s was its heyday. And it was controversial because it looked at the sort of seamy side of life. It looked at crime and passion and secrets. But it located those things very firmly in the middle-class home or the upper-middle-class home, which was seen as very shocking. It sort of, oh, Wilkie Collins had this wonderful phrase, which is very appropriate for here. He talked about the secret theatre of home, which I think is just such a great phrase. Because, you know, we all have these dramas going on in our homes, don't we? And so the sensation fiction was very much about family secrets. I mean, they're kind of like soap operas, really. And they often feature really brilliant women characters. So The Woman in White has Marion Halcombe, who's a sort of early detective, really. There's a wonderful woman called Lydia Gwilt, who's a wicked governess in another Wilkie Collins novel called Armadale. And so I was, you know, I like to tell stories about women's lives, and I like to look at sexuality. And it seemed to me that the novel of sensation was just a great kind of forum for doing that, and that maybe I could
push it a little bit further and make it address issues that even in its own day, as daring as it was, it couldn't quite address. So it's very much an homage to that style of fiction, really, that world.
I love that. Going further with that, so in this sense, did the world came first? Did the characters come next, or did the plot come next? August Wilson talks about his characters speaking to him. Did these two women speak to you?
Did they? The world came first, yes. And to be honest, I kind of pinch something from The Woman in White, which if you read Fingersmith and The Woman in White, you'll know what I'm talking about. And that was my starting point. And I had to then think about who was involved in that scenario and why they were there. So I sort of built the narrative around that. I knew I wanted it to be primarily about women. They had to be young women for the purposes of the plot. I was interested in, there's two main characters, Sue and Maud, and Maud very much belongs to the sort of gothic world of sensation fiction. But I'd also been reading a lot of Victorian journalism, and the Victorians, like us, very interested in their own sort of criminal underworlds. You know, think of Dickens and Oliver Twist. I mean, Dickens was a fantastic investigator of the sort of murky corners of Victorian life. Henry Mayhew was an investigative journalist who went out and talked to ordinary people, including sort of thieves and prostitutes and fences and things like that, and left wonderful records. And so Sue belongs to that kind of world. She's a pickpocket and very much in a sort of Dickensian world. And so for me, the novel was bringing those two worlds together. And so Sue is very, like all of us, she's very at home in her own element, and she can read the codes of her own element, and Maud is very at home in hers and can read her world. But when they cross over, they're rather vulnerable and all at sea, and interesting things happen. So you can hear, I suppose, that it all sort of built up, and the characters were roles for me originally. You know, these girls had to do certain things, but then what's always interesting for me as an author is discovering how they felt about that, how they felt about themselves, how they felt about each other. And I didn't have the very end clear in my head for a while. It took me, I wasn't quite sure how I was going to end the book for a while.
You know, I'd like to ask Alexis, so we kind of got the gen where it started for Sarah. I'm just imagining that it might have started, you might have started with the voices of those women that you say that haunted you, or did you, or were you into the plot and that's how you approached creating the adaptation? Or was it really serving these women's stories first?
Oh, in terms of adapting it?
Yeah, and your response to it.
The thing is, it's all so beautifully baked together. They can't exist without each other in the novel. So there's the plot, but the emotional pull of the characters and their through lines are so compelling that it's not one or the other. So, mm-hmm. So I think both were extremely compelling, and I've always been. This is an area of interest for me as well. So, and I'd read Sarah's other books previously, so I already was kind of hooked into the work that she does, but. In the adaptation of it, it's both. It's like looking at a painting close up and then having to move back and look at it, you know, as a whole. And this is an interesting play because I have actually never adapted anything in terms of writing plays before. And it was quite interesting to do because, in my experience, playwriting is a much more sort of, you know, unconscious, you know, instinctive kind of work that you do, and then you sort of see what you've made. But because I work in storytelling and television and features, I've become much more conscious about what we call breaking stories, which is really thinking about the plot mechanics and how onions need to be peeled so that we're learning the right things at the right time. And the challenge of that was so exciting. I was so hubristic thinking, oh, that'll be interesting. And of course, it's, while I adapted it, I found that I kept going back to Sarah's original impulses because it had been so clearly thought through and was working so beautifully to begin with. But it's a kind of wrestling match of both, I think.
I want to just stay with you for a second because this your first adaptation of a novel. I'm curious, did you, in your first pass at it,
What was your approach? Did you take, go through and create a galley of maybe all of the dialogue first out, or were you working section at a time? Were you, you know, how did you, what was the first pass at it like? I know you brought it into the lab, and we read some of it 2 years ago.
Right, right.
But it was just a small section of it. Right. So I'm just curious, that what was that first, okay, here's the book, where do I start?
Well, it was daunting. It took me 3 months to write 10 pages, and I actually came up here and told Bill that we should, you know, they should give me the commission money back, and I should write to Sarah and tell her this was just going to be too, I wasn't up for it. I couldn't do it. And they all were so kind to me and just said, okay, all right, we'll see you later. Like, just sort of, so, but I did try to wrestle with the story and figure out how to work that through. And I mean, it's a consolidation of time and space is what happens when you theatricalize something. So we had to, but the truth is the novel only occurs over a period of about a year. I mean, there's stuff from the past, but the actual events are relatively consolidated. So it was just hard to leave things behind that were so beautiful and rich. And I mean, that was the hardest part, was sort of zeroing in on the story in its most streamlined version. But yeah,
I kind of, it's so funny, in our panel when you all come back, I want to ask what you did end up having to leave out, and we're not going to answer that right now, but that's curious to me too, what you found you had to leave out to center on the story. But Bill, can you tell us a little bit about the design elements of the actual production, how you decided to create the physical spaces, these two very distinct physical spaces, and then all of London in between, which they kind of traverse? Yeah, can you tell us about the many locations?
Absolutely. You know, Chris Acebo, our associate artistic director, is the set designer, and most of the designers are designers that I've had a long-term relationship with, Deb Dryden, Andre, our brilliant costume designer emerita, and Andre Pluse, our composer, Sean Sagaty, our projections designer, and so it's a great team, and a new lighting designer for me, Alan Edwards, and boy, that those early design meetings, I always have that panic that we're not going to find it. Like, we're not going to find how it's and it is wonderfully sprawling in terms of the two main locations, but lots of other locations. And there's that excitement of the exploration, the openness in it, but also that little seed of, what if this is the time we can't come up with something? But Mr. Acebo just hit on, you know, he's such a metaphoric designer. And he just hit on something that immediately made sense to me. When he hit on the metaphor, and then we took it one more step, and I thought, I know how to stage the entire play now. You know,
tell us what the metaphor?
Well, it was just as simple as having a physical representation of both Lant Street, where Sue comes from, and the Briar Estate, where Maud comes from, having them both on stage at the same time. And what that meant from there. So it was that simple.
That's great. Sarah, I want to ask you this next question, and this is actually a question about language. The New York Times described one of your books, the story appears not merely to be about the novel's time, but to have been written by someone living in that time, thumping out the whole thing on a manual typewriter. Do you write on a manual typewriter? but more than that, in some essence, you are creating your own language or recreating a language. How do you go about doing that?
It's kind of smoke and mirrors, to be honest. It's you've got to persuade people that, you know, this is kind of the right kind of language. So it had to be a kind of there were lots of different ways of writing historical fiction. I mean, John Fowles wrote brilliant historical fiction, but very much with, you know, the narrative voice is very clearly in the present, talking about the past. But I've always liked my narrative voices to feel like they've come from the period that I'm talking about, even when it's in a third person voice, but if when it's in the first person, of course, that's more necessary and acute. And Fingersmith is the novel is told through two voices, Sue's voice and Maud's voice. And as I was saying before, you know, they come from very different worlds. So for Maud, I was looking at Gothic fiction, I was looking at sensation fiction. She's a rather neurotic and sort of slightly damaged kind of character, so the stuff of her own I had to bring to it. Sue belongs to the Victorian underworld, so I was reading lots of Dickens and looking at books of Victorian journalism and just trying... But a big problem with historical fiction is when you ladle on the details, you know, and they're not sort of organic. So I had to let the language settle and feel like when I was using it, it was belonging to the characters. And I just, for me, reading books from a period as well as reading about a period is always a great resource, and the idiom just kind of sinks in. Also, for Fingersmith, there was a guy called Eric Partridge who was a scholar. I think he was New Zealander actually, but he settled in Britain and he was a scholar of language, and he did several dictionaries, including a dictionary of historical slang, which is about 1,500 pages long. It's a wonderful book, and it's got all these glorious old archaic terms, lots of which are sort of sexual, and you know, so many words for genitals. I couldn't even begin to kind of because it's sort of, you know, it's slang and it's yeah. So I went through this whole book the Christmas before I started writing on. Started writing Fingersmith, I went through the whole book and made lists and lists and lists of all these glorious phrases like dolly shop for pawnbrokers and poke and slumming and I don't know, a very small proportion of which finally found their way into the novel. So it was just, you know, it's just some very particular research and some just getting a feel for the language and letting it evolve as suits the novel.
Do you have any phrases from that slang dictionary that you love that you didn't put in the book?
They're all too rude, to be honest. maybe they're just the ones I remembered. just ask me later.
Hey, Miriam, can I jump in with a question for Sarah? One of the things that is so beautiful about what you do is that you use anachronism in a way that helps a reader feel like this is truly a book from that time. And I don't know if you could talk a little bit about that.
They may just be mistakes, you know. You're being very generous in reading them as sort of postmodern touches. What have you got in mind?
Well, I'm thinking of cigarettes, maybe.
Well, weren't cigarettes around in the 1860s?
I don't know, but... or the title for the piece?
Fingersmith. That was a word, you see, I found.
Right.
Fingersmith was a word, allegedly, for a pickpocket, but also for a midwife. And I really liked the two ideas, you know, sort of foraging fingers. Titles come at different stages for me. I don't know about for you with a piece. And some titles, sometimes I'll write a novel without a title and then I have to find a title afterwards. But with Fingersmith, it was when the word came first. I'd found the word while I was working on earlier novels and was so taken with it that I knew it would suit this book.
Yeah. People ask me what it's called. I say Fingersmith and I sort of look at them and I say, it means pickpocket. And then I say, and also what you think it means. Depending on who my audience is.
Alexa, about language, the dialogue that you have in the play, is it all from the book, or did you have to find yourself at some times writing in the Waters style when you created dialogue?
Yeah, there's a lot of dialogue that's taken absolutely from the pages of the book, but there are places where I added or you know, created new language, or there's some scenes in the play that don't exist in the book, although they're completely, to me, this is probably grandiose, but I feel like you implied them, so if you know what I mean, there's still a connection to the book.
So then you had to write in that style to maintain a consistency sort of throughout the piece.
Oh, of course.
That seems like a challenge.
Yeah.
Also, there's the challenge in switching mediums of handling narration. And how did you handle that and approach that? And what have you come up with without, of course, giving away too much? But I don't think we're giving away by saying we use narration in this production. Mm-hmm. But it's a different thing for the theater that serves in a different way. Or it serves in substitute of the description that a novel can write.
Right. Well, again, part of what drew me to the novel and wanting to theatricalize it is that it does have such interesting use of point of view. And I was quite terrified of direct address. I said to Bill, you know, I think it's important for this piece, but I'm afraid of it because, and he asked me to demonstrate what my worst fear was. And so I remember saying, you know, well, then I walked over there and then knock, 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 you know, in a sort of like terrible storytelling, you know, lame kind of thing. But it has not been that, and it's actually been very important to the story that it's about different perspectives and the way we see things.
Well, it does intertwine character. The narration that's used comes out of their situation and furthers, at least in my experience, not only the things that we have to know about the plot, mm-hmm. but also the people who are involved in that plot.
Yeah, yeah.
Bill, well, did the actors teach you anything about using the language?
The actors always teach me about how to use language.
I like that you look at me when you say that.
I look to the actor that I'm working with starting in a month. But no, it's true. This was absolutely no exception. I mean, it's an astonishing cast, starting with Sarah and Erica, who play the two leads, and their insights into why they're saying what they're saying, and the role that they played. Maybe Alexa, you could talk about that a little bit more, but that they had, not only in terms of how they interpreted what Alexa wrote based on what Sarah wrote, but also their own insights that shaped the text in the rehearsal process.
They're both, the level of discourse up here is incredible, and all of the actors were such a huge part of the creation of this piece. It was really a give and take, but so thoughtful and finding things that I had missed that I thought I knew the book inside and out. And we would actually have arguments where the actors would say, well, why can't we have that line? It's in the book. And the way I would trump, you know, the way I would try to get my way was to say, well, no, it's in the book. So, right, very much so, very much so. But the two women helped shape a different, I shouldn't say this to you, but the last scene of the play is a little different than the book, and that came from working with, it's not a different outcome, it's all the good, all the same, but
it's car
it's like
chase.
A dream ballet with Kardashians, but... but that came from direct... me having a conversation with one of the actresses about her through line, and she understood it in a kind of almost irrational but almost irrational way that really, like, I remember having a conversation with Sarah and then later that day with Erica and all these pieces falling into place about what it seemed like the last scene needed to be, so...
Rex, did you want to...
I'll just say, speaking of that last scene, that... I've never worked on a new play before where more changed about the physical production from our original design through opening night. Just in terms of costumes, furniture, there's a lot of beautiful things that were designed and built, clothes, wigs, pieces of furniture that are not in the production anymore. And that was... of course, challenging for our shops, making beautiful things that didn't get used. But it is the nature of new work, and I think this is such a complex story, and we were constantly battling length demons in terms of the piece working within the confines of rotating rep, the fact that we have to go from Fingersmith in the afternoon to Guys and Dolls at night, and we have a very limited amount of time while the audience is, you know, eating dinner. To change over that world, but also what was needed to tell the story. and that in some cases, you know, we realized that Chris Acebo and I had been literal sometimes about things, that it would be more powerful to be more metaphoric and to not just put the real thing on stage, but to allow the audience to imagine more. So that was
We actually talked about we should put all the furniture and costumes that have been cut, because they're so beautiful,
and the characters,
and put them and the characters in the front window where the costumes are on Main Street, but it would be too crowded.
But it's actually a great idea.
I know.
That would be kind of fun, yeah, to have a display of it in some way, shape, or form.
It's quite beautiful.
Sarah, a question for you, and that is, although you were far away, what was your involvement in this process? Was there communication back and forth very much? Were you shown different iterations of the script? I know that there's been a fair amount of changes in the last week or so, too. So I'm just curious. Last 10 minutes? No. Just curious what your process was on this. Did you want to be really hands-on or not, somewhere in the middle?
I was fascinated by what was happening, but I didn't want to get in the way, you know. So I was very happy to keep a distance. I think I saw two drafts of the script. Is that right? Is that how you remember it? Over quite a space of time, and I mean, one thing was, you know, the moment when I first read the script, you know, pretty much the moment I started, I realized that it was really good. And I was in very, you know, I was in, the book was in very safe hands. And then I just became just enthralled with it, with the script, really, and with what you had done. Because although it was always all clear that it was, the play was going to be an adaptation of Fingersmith, you know, it was also clear that it was very much a new play by you, maybe inspired by the book. But you brought so much to it, you know, you brought so much to the characters. That was clearly your own, entirely your own, that suited the spirit of the novel, but was this sort of fantastic extra layer. So it was just delightful, actually, to see those two scripts. I haven't seen the latest version, so I'm really excited about. But I never wanted you to feel burdened by any sense that you know that I might be disappointed or that you might get it wrong or something like that, because I just felt, I remember. We did debate a little bit at a distance, the ending, because the ending has sort of clearly
changed
a bit. I went way
off the rails. Yes.
And my feeling was, my feeling was, to me, this ending doesn't represent the ending of the book, but if this is what Alexa wants to do, you know, actually that's fine, and I'm happy with that, because this isn't the book. You know, this is Alexa's play. I was just interested in the whole thing, really.
As you're speaking, it makes me think about how proprietary and personal the stories that you write. You spend a lot of time writing a novel, and do you have that sense of a possession over your pieces, or do you kind of move on and allow it, like a musician might allow someone else to sing their song, they might do it differently? I'm curious about that in terms of the novel form.
Well, you know, novels, like lots of art forms, they're recreated by every single person who reads them. You know, everybody reads a slightly different novel. Sometimes I meet people who say to me, oh, God, that bit in Fingersmith where, and they'll relate the scene to me, and I think, actually, that's not exactly how I wrote it. You know, it's how it struck you. And then we've probably all had this experience of reading a book several times in our lives, and we find different things in it, you know, depending on how old we are and things like that. So I do feel incredibly possessive about a book when I'm working on it. But I do move on to another book. But the thing is, the book is there, you know, Fingersmith the novel has not been changed by Alexa's play. The book will always remain in the form in which I wrote it. But there's this rather wonderful thing has happened where it's sort of, you know, the Alexa's play is kind of intimately related to the novel, but is something quite distinct in its own right. And that's great, you know, I think.
Was there anything, this is for Alexa and Bill, when, Sarah, when you did read the first two drafts and sent back notes, was there anything in those notes that really struck the two of you that you wanted to...
Well, I don't know. I don't remember... having that much to say, because I was just so pleased with it, with what you had done, so excited by what you had done. And there were very tiny points, as I recall.
Oh, you guys were so so helpful and so thoughtful and so different than the folks that I work with in my day job. and so respectful in terms of the, you know, the way, you know, the thoughts were very, very smart and the questions were incredibly helpful, but they were not prescriptive. They were just, hey, this seems like it might not be working. And of course, I knew that already. So I was just horrified to have had you to, you know, to had to read that particular draft that we're discussing. But it was, yeah, I feel like, you know, I made some plot changes, which I probably had to go through in a way to, in the adaptation, and it was just trying to figure out some stuff. But I knew as soon as I hit send that it wasn't what I wanted, but I had a deadline to these guys. And if I had done that with my day job, they would have thought like, oh my God, the captain has lost her mind, and how can we get her out of here quickly? And but it was such a loving response. Like, we were blown away by the insights and the thoughtfulness that came back from you guys. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are there any, you know, in taking a novel and putting it into this different form of a play, there's a condensation that has to happen and conflation. And I'm just wondering if there are any of the characters that are different in tone and function in the play than they are in the novel.
Oh, that's
interesting. And can we talk about that without giving away too much? I mean,
no.
And check,
well,
please.
Well, I can think of one thing, okay. the doctor. So, sure. You know, we have a cast of 14, is that correct?
14.
And they're all doubling and tripling roles, which is really exciting to see. It's the rep inside the rep, right? But you know, there was a situation where we had a character who needed to be, as the rewrites progressed, there were two doctors, and we had a character who needed to be in another scene, and we literally couldn't get him there in a way that felt natural, so he had to become one character, and initially there was a sort of sympathetic doctor and a more opportunistic doctor, and so the character evolved to serve the play in a different function.
Yeah.
So things like that were kind of born of necessity, but I think are quite interesting. Mm. Mm-hmm.
That the practical in some ways dictated the change of tone.
Yeah.
And that somehow, for you, actually stripping away in terms of the physical world became, the physical world changed in tone to be more metaphorical than actual, than...
In some cases, absolutely. The other thing I'll say is that a lot of the work that Alexa has done over these 2 months, just the practicalities of making the story come alive on stage, it takes a certain amount of time for somebody to go from one costume to another costume. And the piece is partly about dressing and undressing, right? That's a key. It's a core part of the story, and so there are scenes that came about originally to help with the flow of the practicalities of costumes that now have become, you know, an integral part of the story, mm-hmm. and it's impossible to imagine the story without them. But their genesis was very much in the practical. Which is, how are we getting from that person being in that to them being in this other look?
Okay, this is kind of a... I was intrigued by this, Sarah. So in your acknowledgments, you list 3 books, The Hanging Tree, Legally Dead, and the Henry Spencer bibliographies. And I'm just curious about those books. You mentioned them as being things that helped shape Fingersmith for you. Can you talk a little bit about those books? And
yeah, sure. I mean, there were loads of books, you know, that informed me when I was writing Fingersmith, but I picked those because they gave me sort of bits of information, I suppose, that became quite crucial. And The Hanging Tree is a history of public executions in Britain.
Fantastic.
Did you read it?
Oh, yes.
Oh, it's absolutely wonderful. It's by a guy called Vic Gatrell. And it covers, I think, 1780 to 1868, which was when public executions finally came to an end in the UK. And it's an exemplary piece of social history because, you know, people like Dickens went to see a hanging because he was so interested in everything. He went to see a public hanging and he wrote very much about the crowd. They attracted huge crowds. And for a middle-class observer like him, the crowds often seemed to be callous and just there for the thrill and a mob, basically, and quite frightening. But what Vic Gatrell does is to look at popular cultural sources and all sorts of things to sort of write a much more compassionate history about the poor and their relationship with criminality and hangings and the complexity, basically the complexity of a popular response to that sort of very, very brutal event. So, yeah, that was a great resource in all sorts of ways for information and also sort of his tone, really, you know. And Legally Dead is a novel, a memoir from, I think, like 1910 by a woman called Hamilcar. What's her first name? I can't remember now. Gosh. Anyway, and there were a lot of asylums. There were lots of private asylums in Victorian Britain. And the thing about a private asylum, as opposed to a public asylum, is that they actually need lunatics, you know, to kind of make as a business venture. And so they had a sort of interest in getting people confined in them. You needed, this comes back to the doctors. You needed two doctors to certify you as insane. And so there was lots of scope for rather unscrupulous doctors to certify vulnerable people and get them in their institutions. And it was really hard to get out. And what struck me when I was researching asylums was, you know, our image of the Victorian asylum is that it's a great gothic, dark, damp, creepy structure. But in fact, most asylums were these much smaller establishments with maybe 30 people, maybe 10 people. Lots of them were women. And it wasn't that you were there, it wasn't that you were trapped there because you were in chains or sort of in a straitjacket. Often it was simply that you were friendless, you had no money, you had no resources, you might have had no hat and coat. I mean, at a time when, as a respectable woman, you had to be wearing a hat and coat. If somebody takes your hat and coat away from you, it's very difficult to go out, and very quickly you can become demoralized. So Legally Dead, it's much later than my 1860 period, but it's a fantastic moving account of being trapped in an asylum and getting out. And there were lots of scandals in the 19th century about women. Actually, they often were women, but men too, who were sort of, you know, tricked into asylums, really, and had a terrible time getting out. Was there
Spencer bibliographies,
which
I couldn't
believe
existed.
Can I talk about this without giving too much away?
Okay.
There was a Victorian book collector called Henry Spencer Ashby who amassed an enormous collection of books, but he was also very interested in pornography, and he amassed a huge pornographic collection too, and he compiled these three great bibliographies. It was a really sort of nerdy thing to do. And he spent years and years, he wanted to kind of capture every pornographic book that had ever been published and write a sort of description of it. And it's a sort of endless project, because just as he thought he'd finished, you know, he'd find some more and he'd have to kind of... And he bequeathed his entire collection to the British Library. He bequeathed his sort of mainstream books, but he stipulated that the British Museum, the British Library, could only have them if they also took the pornography. So they were compelled to take the pornography, and they put it, along with some other collectors' pornography, they put it in a special, what they called the private case collection, where when I was researching Fingersmith, I'd go and read some of these pornographic books and call them up from the special collection. And you had to sit at a special desk in the British Library.
Behind that red curtain.
Yeah. Well, they could keep an eye on you, basically.
Maybe we could put some of those, we could have the British Museum send them, and we could put those on Main Street. So
it was a sort of fantastically subversive thing to do of him, you know. But it's also a rather... You know, it's an odd project, and lots of those books are troublesome, especially for a woman reader. But some of them are fascinating. And what interested me in thinking about Victorian pornography was, yes, of course, it was largely written by men, and it was largely published and distributed by men. But we do know that some women were involved in the business, and certainly, I imagine, prostitutes
would have encountered pornography. Maybe it would have been in brothels. And who knows what other kinds of women might have encountered pornography from time to time. And so I was interested in how possible it might be for women to make their own reading, you know, to read those texts in their own kind of way, and possibly even, you know, imagine their own maybe feminist pornographic scenarios. I don't know. But he was a fascinating guy.
Yes, truly.
Anyway, I'll just ask this final question, and then maybe we'll open it up. But I wanted to ask, what would you love the audience to be on their lips as they exited the theater at 4:30 or at whenever the show gets out this afternoon?
What would I like?
Either one of you. Actually, I'd like you all to answer this question.
Well, for me, you know, it was, for me, Fingersmith was all about the narrative. There's lots. You know, novels, they're incredibly life-affirming things. They celebrate what's best about us as human beings, our capacity for invention and for surprising people. And so there's a great narrative relish in the novel of Fingersmith. And one of the fascinating things about this process is that I know that I will see that relish and excitement, that narrative excitement, translated into a theatrical experience. So I suppose what I would like readers of Fingersmith to take away from the novel is a kind of a wow, you know, and it would be lovely if theatregoers were saying the same sort of thing as they left the auditorium.
Well, my first response was, wow, I really enjoyed Guys and Dolls. But that aside, which I did, I think something similar. I think about feeling like that you had a great ride and that the story is ultimately has, you know, you feel the humanity of it. And in some way that's lifting. So a lot of fun, but also it asks hard questions, and I'm glad about that.
Bill, any thoughts?
I just love Sarah's word "wow," and that is it. You know, I would love people to say "wow" when they're walking out.
Thank you so much, Coco.
I want to thank all of you for joining us for this opening weekend. It's been a spectacular weekend, and your presence makes it so joyful. Thank you for joining us. Thank you all for joining us for this panel, for coming all this way, Sarah. Truly, thank you, Alexa and Bill. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.